that reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The first reading is from Acts chapter 5. But Peter and the apostles answered, "You must obey God. Resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance couple of days earlier, they had watched in horror as Jesus was dragged away to be crucified. Most of the disciples had swooned up by the angel. Now, the risen Lord stands in their midst. He's not a ghost. They're not hallucinating as some have insinuated. Jesus is standing in the flesh. The very one they saw beaten and mocked. The one they saw nailed to the cross. The one whose lifeless body they saw placed into a tomb. It's now standing in front of them. In the flesh. Jesus is risen. He is risen indeed. In the flesh. And Jesus could have admonished his disciples on the spot for their doubts and unbelief. He could have chewed them out for their lack of trust. What happened to you guys? Did you even stay awake in the garden? And what happened to you, Peter? What happened to you? I will never deny you, Lord. No one would have blamed him if he would have just ripped him off. He doesn't speak harshly. As always, Jesus has compassion. He calms their fears with words of hope. With gentle patience, he says to them, "Peace be with you." The disciples abandon him in his hour of greatest need. Jesus doesn't wait for the disciples to come to him. He didn't emerge from the tomb and head off to the local diner for a cup of coffee. He waited for the disciples to get their act together. Jesus goes to them. He goes to them because he has something they need. He goes to the disciples because he knows their spirit. Jesus. Jesus doesn't wait for the world to come to you. John call all men into the office of the Holy Ghost. And he is ordinary and humble given the task of publicly administering this precious gift of forgiveness. God's people. In one of his sermons, Luther has a wonderful explanation of this relationship between Christ, his pastors, and those gathered in the room. He says, "It is a great and excellent thing for the mouth of every honest minister and preacher to be Christ's mouth, and his word and forgiveness to be Christ's word and forgiveness. If you sin and confess it, believing on Christ, then your minister and preacher will forgive you the same sin in Christ's place. And the words which he speaks on God's behalf, you ought to accept as if Christ had spoken them to you. Therefore, it is right to call the word of the minister and the preacher which he preaches God's word. For the office is not the minister's or the preacher's, but God's. And the word that he preaches is likewise not the minister's or the preacher's, but God's." When a rightly called and ordained pastor stands in front of you on Sunday morning, forgives you of your sins, it's as though Jesus was standing in front of you, as he did with his disciples, saying, "Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Your sins are forgiven. All of your fears and doubts amount to nothing. I've taken them all away." Luther goes on to say, "If anyone knew of a church on earth where God's voice could be heard, how he would run to get there. Yet he would do nothing other than what he hears from the minister of Holy Jesus." Luther spoke these words nearly 500 years ago. And yet, what a timely message for us in our day. When people think they see Jesus everywhere, the grilled cheese sandwiches, the mildew on the bathroom wall, thank you. We've got it all right here in our little church on the corner of the world. All of the gifts that Jesus has for us right here. All of the hope of the resurrection and life everlasting is yours. It wasn't enough that Thomas had heard Jesus tell him he would rise from the dead. It wasn't enough that the women came on Easter morning to tell him of an empty tomb. It wasn't enough that Mary Magdalene told of seeing the risen Lord and talking to him on top of that. Thomas wanted more. He wanted rock solid proof, evidence of touch and feel. Every day, but we pass them by, paying no more heed to them than if a cow were mooing at us. We too want more. The devil tricks us into thinking that the grass is greener everywhere else. The problem is, we want Christ. It's not enough that we have God's word as a precious treasure. It's not enough that He gives us His good relationships. Want. Constantly telling him that his gifts are bland, run-of-the-mill, uninspiring, and boring. How does that have any difference when you tell him that he deals with our doubt and unbelief just as he did Thomas, the other disciples. Gives us hope. The love of Jesus will always be stronger than our doubts. As a conclusion, I have one final selection from Dr. Luther. So we see in this story, not only in the example of Thomas, but also in the example of the other disciples, what a very gracious Lord we have in Christ, who treats us neither sternly nor harshly, but seeks us out and comforts us as He does for us. He does not say to the disciples, "You have forsaken me. You were offended at me. You ran from me and denied me. So now I do not want you anymore." He bears with long suffering and weakness. He does not make them suffer for the fact that they sin. Lord Christ, the pastor of the Lamb, the once born to us.